pleasure meeting you, man. Really, thanks for the introduction.
Thank you. Pardon me while I get comfortable. I encourage you to do the same.
Well, I'm going to keep mine on.
So we're going to do this just like we're two guys sitting around on a Sunday afternoon after watching our home teams play. For those of you that don't know the Bears score, I won't tell you. And
if you don't tell him because he's taping it on his DVR.
That's what it is. So.
Oh, I know that.
So we're just getting to know each other. We've been together for all of about 20 minutes now. And it is a storied relationship. We've had an awful lot of time to bond.
Yes.
But what I haven't told him is how I wanted to start. So in doing my research for this interview, I watched, of course, everything that I could Google, that I could find online. And there was this talk about the play Waiting for Godot and how important it was to him. And so being familiar with the play, I was like, okay, I can see how all of that works. And then I saw how the play was staged, and it changed everything for me. So for those of you who don't know, it's an existential play. There's two gentlemen standing at the crossroads of a street and working out why they're there and what their purpose is. And I'll let Mr. Pierce speak to that in a moment. The part that was so impressive for me was they did it on the street where the devastation from Katrina happened. You're watching a community sit in the middle of trauma and processing that live, not in the artificial world that we as theater artists create. You're watching that happen live in front of you at a street you use every day, going back and forth in your comings and goings. And that resonance changed everything. And it became the point that I wanted to frame this conversation around. So I'm going to tease you. We're not going to start there. I want to start with some background first so that we get to why that moment was so important for you. Mm-hmm. So let's start at the beginning, man. Tell me about growing up in New Orleans.
Well, New Orleans, first of all, thank you, Chicago, and the Humanities Festival for having me. Chicago is a very special place to me. When I would, in my school year, we have relatives here on the South Side, and so many times, I may have one or two of my relatives here. We would get on the highway and drive to Chicago. It was a great adventure. And as I say in the book, my father had a philosophy, you can't get lost in America. Right. He gave us all great wanderlust. It wasn't just a philosophy of navigation, when my mother would be chastising him about being lost. He would turn to her and say, you can't get lost in America. Boys, you can't get lost in America. It was a philosophy that you can do anything, you can envision what you want to do in life and achieve it by hard work, vision, perseverance, resilience. And all of those variables came into play, especially in these last few years after the disaster, the flood of New Orleans. But Chicago was very fond and is and still is very fond in my memory and a great place to visit and have the Saints come and play every once in a while and get beat every once in a while. And you have the most amazing winters I've ever experienced. I was just reminiscing about a two-block walk I took from which is now the Westin Hotel, mm-hmm. to a restaurant right on Lakeshore.
Right.
And when I got there, he said, Mr. Pierce, what can we do for you? We have your reservation. I said, you can get me a cab back to the hotel when I'm through, because I'm not walking. Right. Those are my Chicago memories. And coming to the South Side, 98th and Jeffers, they had a great roller rink there. A memory of growing up in New Orleans was a place where it's the northernmost Caribbean city. Mm. It's the last Bohemia. It's the city that care forgot because nobody really cares because we're living life and enjoying life. Mm. It is a violent city with a violent past, that while people wander and tour the French Quarter, they pass without any sort of significance the plaques on St. Louis and Charters, where the greatest slave exchange was, where most black folks in America, in the southern part of this country, came through. A literal trail of tears from the Mississippi River 6 blocks to Congo Square, where on Sundays those same Africans created one of the great American art forms of jazz, hearing that African six of and the oom-pa-pa of our European captors, oom-pa-pa, oom-pa-pa, and then putting it together and combining it into oom-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa-pa- before they even found their physical freedom. Yeah. And that was the beginning of how culture played an important role in New Orleans history, that it wasn't just a piece of entertainment, that it was a means of insurrection. It was a means of revolt. It was a means of rebellion. It was a means of rejuvenation. It was a means of restitution. Going forward, you get to segregation and Jim Crow, you had the social aid and pleasure clubs that created the second lines that we all know. You see the umbrellas and the handkerchiefs come out, and you hear the band, and everybody knows around the world what a second line looks like in the second line parade and the jazz funerals of New Orleans. But it came about because black folks weren't allowed to get burial plots, couldn't get access to health care. They were redlined by the insurance companies, so they couldn't get insurance. And so we pooled our money in social aid and pleasure clubs. We understand the pleasure part, but we forget about the social aid part, that safety network, that social aid, that benevolence, that benevolent organization. So if your mama takes sick, we're going to take care of you.
Yeah.
If your daddy dies, we're going to send him off right. So you pull out your handkerchiefs and you pull out your umbrellas. Very practical in New Orleans. If you've ever been there in August, you understand why we have umbrellas and handkerchiefs, because you're going to sweat. And so our art and our culture wasn't something that was trivial. It was tangible. It was real in our lives. And then as I was growing up and becoming interested in being an actor, that culture was always around me.
Right.
The expression of the individual being free, improvisation, jazz, within the form of the song, within the notes, the finite number of notes with an infinite amount of possibilities. It was the American aesthetic on display in the form of culture and art. And so then you had a group like Free Southern Theater that inspired me to be an actor, a group that went around the country, around the South, especially during the Civil Rights Movement, doing plays during the Civil Rights Movement during the 20th century, under the threat of violence sometimes. And my parents would go to those plays and come back and tell me about the play because I was too young. But I was always excited, and then later worked with some of the people, you know, Chikula Chajiwa, Kalamu Yasalam, and Tom Dent, who had worked with Free Southern Theater. And so it taught me and gave me a legacy that culture wasn't passive.
Right.
It was real, it was vibrant and tangible, and not just a piece of entertainment. So that was my upbringing in New Orleans.
Nice. So I'm processing all of this. I'm with you guys, honestly. I mean, it's fan of his work. So let's just get that out of the way real quick. fan of the work. I believe me and my wife sat around and binged on all of The Wire. I think we're in the second season at that point. Came across it in reruns and absolutely OD'd on that. Have family in and out of New Orleans, would come up and introduced us to Treme. Didn't know you were on the show at the time.
Oh, wow.
Watching that whole time. Occasionally, get a kick out of you running around on Ray Donovan and doing your work over there as well. So clearly there's this host of work. My baby sister says to me, "Ain't that the guy from Wait Until It's Hail?"
Oh yeah.
That's him. She's like, "I'm gonna be there." And shout out for her because it's her birthday today and she's here, so she is blushing. You'll know her by the fact that she's the one blushing at that statement. So there's this tremendous body of work, right? But we still got to ground it. So there's this possibility all the time when we talk about our journeys that it's how do we get to this notion of our access as artists from our common everyday origins. And there's this opportunity that we have, which is clearly the same one we have today, where we get to use that platform to talk about the things that are important to us, that resonate for us. But I want you guys to be grounded in something really specific. So I want to know about Pontchartrain Park, the place mm-hmm. where your parents bought their first house, and what that place was then when you were a little boy, and how that helped make you into the person you are.
Pontchartrain Park was a neighborhood that was founded in the 1950s in post-World War II suburbia, which is really a part of the city now. When black folks didn't have access to purchase those homes in segregated New Orleans, you weren't allowed to purchase the homes. We were still trying to protect our right to vote then. My father came back from Saipan, where he fought in World War II, came back and didn't have the protection of his right to vote, didn't have access to purchase a home, didn't have access even to the French Quarter. He couldn't go down there if you were a man, woman, or family of color. One of the other things of ugly things about segregation in New Orleans was even green space. We sit here so close to Grant Park. You could not go into a park in New Orleans except for one day of the week, Wednesdays, if you were black, Negro Day. Your black butt couldn't even go into the forest, basically, right. Except one day out of the week. I almost said the wrong thing in church.
Yeah. Don't worry about it, man. There's nothing but forgiveness yes. in this place. You all good.
And so out of that was a great advocacy led by this wonderful civil rights attorney, A.P. Turow, right. who led the advocacy for access to green space. And a powerful part of the civil rights movement in New Orleans. And to appease that movement, the city government decided to do this set-aside of New Orleans, of property of Pontchartrain Park, which is 200 acres, 1,000 homes around this golf course, designed by Joseph Bartholomew. Joseph Bartholomew designed most of the courses, the golf courses in New Orleans, but couldn't play on them because he was a man of color. He was African-American. He used to walk the course at night so that no one would see him on the golf course and he wouldn't get arrested. I choose to believe that they stole that and put it in Bagger Vance. If you remember that movie, when Will Smith walks the course at night with the lantern, I was like, that's Mr. Joe. That's how Mr. Joe used to do it. Mm-hmm. And so this community, out of something ugly, became something beautiful. It became bucolic. It became the classic American middle-class neighborhood to grow up in. It was like a black Mayberry. It became an incubator for black talent. Our first black mayor, Dutch Morial, who was also a famous civil rights attorney in New Orleans and started the SCLC. His son, Mark Morial, who became mayor and is now the national president of the Urban League. Lisa Jackson, who was the EPA director in the first part of the Obama administration. Terrence Blanchard, a jazz composer and orchestrator. I like to include myself in that number now, mm-hmm. being an actor who's accumulated a little bit of a resume.
A little bit.
Right, a little bit. Yeah. And so it was an incubator of talent, and it was a great place to grow up. We had multi-denominational churches, Southern University at New Orleans, Historic Black College, New Orleans division was there. And so it was a place of great pride. And it was also at the deepest part of the flooding. And I knew that it would be blasphemous for us to allow it to be a memory and never come back. That this Moses generation had given us, the Joshua generation, a great place to grow up and a foundation to go out to be successful men and women. Pontchartrain Park was to New Orleans what Sweet Auburn was to Atlanta, mm-hmm. what Baldwin Hills was to Los Angeles, which many of the neighborhoods of the South Side and West Side are to Chicago. In the midst of the darkest hours of this nation and its transition, black folks formed really strong, bonding communities like Pontchartrain Park to give their children the best opportunity to be successful when this country eventually wake up and service all of their citizens. And so it was blasphemous to let it go. And so I said, I can't do that. And that was one of the things that motivated me to get involved. It was one of the awakenings that happened when I did that play, yeah. Waiting for Godot, which we'll get to in your time.
I'm teasing them, man. I'm teasing them. This is how you get them to come back after the commercial, right? Mm-hmm. Okay. Nice. All right, so we'll jump ahead. I know you're eager, right? But not all the way there. I want to talk about Juilliard for a minute.
So, oh, yes.
So you painted this picture for me now. I have a sense of what Pontchartrain Park is. Juilliard's a half a world away in real estate and a world away in terms of opportunity. So how do we make that jump?
There is a great institution in New Orleans called the New Orleans Center for Creative Arts. It is our performing arts high school. It is a place where you could go half the day, you can get your academics anywhere you wanted to, mm-hmm. and half the day there to study whichever discipline you chose, music, theater, writing, visual arts. Mm. We now have culinary arts. And so I went there with a couple of musician friends of mine, like Branford Marcellus and Terrence Blanchard, like mm-hmm. I told you before. There was a guy at my regular high school, Benjamin Franklin High School, which is a college prep. I had the best of both worlds. His name was Wynton Marcellus. Mm-hmm. I went there with him.
He's got a little resume, too.
Yeah, he has a little resume, too. He's been on the come up the past yeah. couple of years. There was a little kid. There was a little kid there, man. I can see him right now. He went to Jesuit High School in his little khakis. And, man, Wynton and them would show him how to play stuff. And he was playing around town. He had learned a lot, but mm-hmm. he was learning a lot, you know. He was like the Opie of the jazz department, right? And his name was Harry Connick Jr., right? I went back to the school to speak a couple of times, and there was this young actor who said, I want to be like you, Mr. Pierce, and I'm going to go to Juilliard like you and all of that. And I said, you know, you hang in there, little Anthony Mackie. You'll do well. One day you might get a job, buddy, you know.
So it's a Anthony, tough business, but hang in there.
Yeah, right, hang in there. Right, right. And, you know, today I see him, I'm like, Anthony, I can play your daddy. it was a real place of study. It right. was some place that said, we actually didn't do plays. Mm. They wanted us to figure out how to do the work, how to study the text, how to understand, you have to become a student of your craft. Mm. For actors, become a student of human behavior, the acting, and develop your talent by understanding that you're going to come into contact with so many different teachers. No one can actually teach you how to be an artist.
Right.
They can give you their philosophy, they can give you their technique, and you are the one that takes a brick from each teacher and decide which ones you throw away and which ones you build your house with and build your foundation with. And so they taught me that way of working and understanding the process and all. And it prepared me to go to Juilliard, and I knew at that point, I kind of identified different training programs around the country that I wanted to go to, and mm-hmm. Juilliard was on the top of the list. At the same time, I had an academic career. Ben Franklin was the top school in Louisiana, still is. It's in one of the top 10 schools in the country academically, and I applied and was going to different, academic schools. I remember, you know, I was going to come to the University of Chicago. I was going to go to Brandeis, Sarah Lawrence in New York. So I was looking at all those schools at the same time, and then I got the letter that I was going to Juilliard, and I was like, bye. Right. Juilliard accepted 19 students, one of the largest classes to that point, and I knew to be in that exclusive group that it was going to be something special. And that's how I, on August 19th, 1981, traveled to New York City. I remember the day.
That's not a bad move, man. you can tell I'm a fan because I'm just over here going, that's so nice. we don't have as much time as I would like, because I would like to do like 3-4 hours of this. But I've been told I don't have quite that much time. So we could spend an enormous amount of time on your career. I was looking on the database at the work. Mm-hmm. It's a little more than a little bit of a resume. But since I know my wife will kill me if I don't start here, mm-hmm. so The Wire, let's start there.
Yes.
So I was reading this thing, again, I did a lot of research on this, right? So I'm catching the part where you and the writer are having this conversation about black people, police officers in particular, and this notion that police are going, choosing to be police officers because they want to help people. But there's this choice, this active sort of mm-hmm. notion of making positive change.
Yeah.
And that's not usually part of the conversation that we're usually playing with. Because we don't have all day to go into all of the pieces I want to go into, mm-hmm. I just wanted to give you a moment to speak to what the show means to you personally, mm-hmm. as a sort of testament to a part of your work that so many of us have deep affection for, and yeah, and how it felt to be in that environment, in that crucible for that five seasons, right?
Yes.
Five seasons.
First of all, we didn't know The Wire was going to be The Wire. Right. I remember when we first saw the first two episodes, me and Sonia Son, who played Kima, and Andre Royo, who's now on Empire, he played Bubbles. We watched the screening of the first two episodes and said, you better save your money, man. This is going to be canceled. I distinctly remember that. We went away, and as an audience, we were like, man.
So we got nothing.
We got nothing. I'm like, oh, man, we thought this was going to be the one. We thought so. It's not. But what we realized after a year or two that it had got, you know, some attention from folks, and it was becoming a little cult following. And we literally had to convince HBO every season to bring it back. Most people don't know that. And David humbled himself and didn't throw a tantrum and saying, I brought you this masterpiece, you better put it back on. He would do it. He would show them what the next season would look like, actually give them an outline before they would come to the decision to put it on. I know now they are so happy they did, because I meet someone every month who has just watched The Wire for the first time. And there are two people in the world, people who are avid fans like yourself and other people who haven't seen one second. Yeah. But they have heard so much about The Wire from people like you.
We pass it around, right? Pretty much like heroin. Yeah. Like, you gotta try this, man. It's good, man. It's good. It'll be good, yeah, baby. Man. Come on.
I'm gonna get The Wire. Second season.
It's good,
got second
man.
Season here. Everybody got second season. My
loose
third.
Loose square, two socks, The Wire.
Right.
It's good.
And so The Wire will be that first line in my obituary. Right, Wendell Pierce, who played Bunk Borland, died today at 115. Right.
In 6 months, right? Nice, you know, nice.
So it was very special. The moment that you were talking about is after I had done all this research. Right. In my third year, I was a little... David has a belief, David Simon, the creator and the writers, believe that you shouldn't give the actors any advance notice of what the arc of their role, the storyline, will be. Because they... Like actors will say, oh man, I know I got the big scene in the barbershop
play
coming down the way.
So yeah,
and they have sometimes have the tendency that, you know, three episodes before, you know, the big scene in the barbershop, they'll just conveniently be talking about, you know, I need to go get my hair cut at the barbershop. You know? I hope nothing happens there, you know. So they always kept it. I disagree with that. I think actors do not have to tip the hand like that. Right. But he protected himself by not giving. So this one particular season, the third season, I think it was, and I was chasing a gun. Mm. I was chasing a gun. And I was very frustrated and on the set talking to another actor saying, like, I've done all of this research. There's so much rich material here. I've met so many people, so many officers, so many African-American officers. Who found out, you know, that, and I found out that they became officers because they knew the crime that was happening in their community represented so few of the people that lived there. It was 1%. 99% of the people are good, hardworking people and decent people, and they became officers because of that. And what an honorable thing, and the conflict that they have within themselves when they see how policing is happening in the community and all of that. We need to get into that, and we actually know the criminals, you know? Their officers know because they're trying to stop them and all. And I was complaining. And one of the writers, George Pelicanos, was sitting behind me, and he said, Wendell, you're chasing the gun because it's gonna lead you to Omar. And
fans.
Yes. Nice. Omar, for those of you who don't know, Omar was one of the most amazing characters ever created in American television, a homicidal robber of drug dealers, but who had a cold and was fascinating, a fascinating character, fascinating study. And he would, and one of the most popular characters on The Wire, if not the most popular. And he, And me chasing the gun would lead me to Omar. And he said, I knew you guys have a connection because you went to the same high school and you're from the same community. And I would like to take some of the stuff that I heard you say and put it in there. Mm-hmm. I was actually told a story about my girlfriend's father. who used to say he grew up in Oklahoma in the 30s, and he was known to be very smart. They called him schoolboy. He was going to be making it. They knew he was going to get out of the community and break through the segregation and get an opportunity. So even the thugs in the community in a segregated America mm-hmm. understood their role. So if they ever saw a schoolboy in the wrong place, her father, they would take care of him and said, no, schoolboy, you don't belong here. You're going somewhere. We're going to take care of you. Get out of here. This is our world, not mm-hmm. yours. And he used that in that same scene. So if you remember when I meet Omar on the bench, and I tell him, we know this community. You understood. I used to be called schoolboy. They kept me out of that. Mm-hmm. Even the thugs when I was growing up understood and had a sense of community and how important it was to take care of each other. But yet now you come along and there's all mm-hmm. these bodies, so no more bodies. And it showed you the relationship of those African-American officers with their community and even having a relationship with the very men, young men, that they probably were chasing mm-hmm. and trying to arrest. But understanding that there was a sense of community that we were disconnecting from and having an adverse effect, and they put that in there. And that has become one of my favorite scenes in The Wire, nice. When Bunk meets Omar in the park.
Beautiful. So I know there's a stage manager around here at some point going, babe, you got 15 minutes. When are you going to get back to that play? So here's the thing. In order to get to the play, I'm going to ask you to indulge me.
No problem.
It's your parents' home. You're on your way home to visit them.
Yes.
Storm's on its way, and it's supposed to miss New Orleans, right?
So
this is the backdrop. It's not really going to hit here. Might be a little water, but it's all going to be fine. So we can talk about the aftermath, but first, the math. What mm-hmm. what was it like... dealing with, you know, the urgencies that we forget that the privileged few of us that get a chance to work in the business, that people forget we have lives and families mm-hmm. and mothers and fathers and homes and connections and people that we want to protect and hold dear. So this is mom and dad.
Right.
Paint that picture for me, man. What was it like?
I was coming home for a vacation. We were about to start the season in Baltimore. I usually would travel home and we would have like a family vacation before I would go to Baltimore. I flew into New Orleans that Saturday. I was meeting my two nieces and sister-in-law from New York, and we were gonna have a week's vacation. My parents were there waiting for us. I flew in that Saturday and there was this chaos at the airport, and I said, what's going on? They said, the hurricane. Mm-hmm. I said, the one in Florida? Mm-hmm. They said, yeah, it made a left turn, it's coming this way. I'm like, oh man, really? Right on my vacation. That's all I could think about. Typical New Orleanian, because I know there's some people here from Treme, even from New Orleans, you know, hey, hurricane coming is something that we hear a good 5-6 times mm-hmm. a summer. So I'm thinking it's going to be 2 days of kind of a miscue on my week-long vacation. So I get home, my parents said, well, this looks bad, we should evacuate. And I said, wait. And I tried to bluff them. I said, if they make it a mandatory evacuation, mm-hmm. we'll leave. But we're not going to leave unless that happens. Now, New Orleans had never had a mandatory evacuation in all its years. And so that Sunday morning...
So you're bluffing is what you're saying.
I'm bluffing.
All right.
I go out. I have a good time that night with nobody out in New Orleans, which was amazing for a Saturday night. Mm-hmm. And I came back, and that Sunday morning, they called a mandatory evacuation. And I said, okay, this must be real. So we're packing the cars. My elderly parents and my father had broken his leg in a car accident then, and we have two cars, and we're packing it, and I keep telling my mother, we're just going for 2 days. Why are we packing all these clothes? And so I had a hangover, I must confess. And in this house of worship, I can say the good Lord takes care of fools and babies. And I ain't no baby, so you know I was a fool. I told my parents, you guys go. I'm going to stay. So I took a nap as they were packing the car and about to leave, and I fell asleep, and I woke up about 25 minutes later, and they were still packing the car. So I said, all right, let me go with you. And that's the only reason I wasn't left in my home, which was inundated with 20 to 25 feet of water for 3 weeks. I would have been amongst many of the people who either swam to safety or got out of there or lost their lives. Because it was Pontchartrain Park, we went to Sunday Mass, that Sunday morning, right before we started to pack the cars, and there was a couple that lived around the corner from us who we asked, you know, what are you going to do, Mayhem? My father said, and he said, I think the wife and I, we're gonna ride it out. Mm. And I always think of them because this elderly couple that grew up with my father in Gertown, neighborhood of New Orleans, lost their lives just feet from our home. They found him in the home, found him in a tree, but he tried to climb out of the water and the tree fell over into the water and he still drowned. And his wife, who had limited mobility, was in the house and drowned. So I always try to remember, and whenever you think of New Orleans, before you get into the politics of recovery and how we get back or not get back, or if we should have saved New Orleans, like some of you outsiders believe, or not, remember that people lost their lives. And the thing that amazed me is we got outside of the city. We were actually in the storm with my uncle and his family. We lost power. And one of the worst things I ever heard in my life, as we were prepared, we had our transistor radios, turned it on, and they said, "This is the emergency broadcast system. This is not a test." And that was the most frightening thing I had ever heard. We were so accustomed to hearing the test. When they said, "This is not a test," the levees in New Orleans have broken. For anyone living in New Orleans, you hear that, you know the city's gonna fill up like a bowl. Mm-hmm. It's like the big one we're waiting on in California, the big earthquake. And the poetic truth of the matter is this. People of New Orleans who had evacuated tried to make a Dunkirk run and go back to the city and save those who didn't make it out. That's what most people don't know. Water, food, if you had a car and you could travel, drive back to New Orleans, there are people stranded at the Superdome and people stranded at the convention center, pick them up. And we were stopped by government. We were stopped by the federal government specifically, the same federal government that has the 82nd Airborne that can go anywhere in the world in 48 hours, but couldn't make it from Georgia to New Orleans except for a week. And yes, I do not have revisionist history when it comes to George W. Bush. He flew over the city. This has nothing to do with politics. This has to do with the President of the United States in Air Force One seeing the disaster of New Orleans and deciding to do a flyover to just check it out and then say to the governor, "You have not given me the technical document necessary for the federal government to respond." And in that time, 1,800 of my neighbors died. Died. While we're fighting foreign wars. I'll never forgive the man for that. Mm-hmm. President Johnson. Mm-hmm. And that has nothing to do with politics. That has everything to do with the fact that we had so many people who called me. This is the matter.
Right, right.
People who called me in the middle of the night, because that's the only time your cell phone would work. And I'd say, "Hey man, we are in trouble down here. You don't understand, the city has flooded. There are people at the convention center and at the Superdome. We have to get to them. We send people down, get the word out." And they said, "Wendell was on TV." I'm like, "No, I can't be on TV. Because if it was on TV, people would be here."
Right, right, right.
And they said, "No, it's on TV." And when we got power back and I saw it on TV, that broke my heart. I'm recognizing people in the crowd. Mm-hmm. And it broke my heart. It angered me to no end. So that is what I will always remember. We always say, never forget, never forget. That's a thing we should never forget, how people were treated. American citizens, once again, we watched it on TV, like we watched Edmund Pettus Bridge on TV as families were separated, herded together. The Coast Guard going against orders, save New Orleans. Because the men and women of the Coast Guard said, "We're not waiting for Washington,
right,
and we're gonna act." So that was the flood of New Orleans. Mm. Because of subpar, poorly designed Army Corps of Engineer levees, we lost the suit against that, holding them culpable. Insurance companies who didn't honor my parents' insurance company, didn't honor 50 years of premiums. They got $400 for losing their home. And they got away with the biggest crime in history because people don't even realize that you pay premiums. No homeowner policy in New Orleans was honored. So then people gave up the ghost. They sold their homes. And so now these young, new people moving into New Orleans who are gentrifying neighborhoods are saying, look how wonderful it is. If it wasn't for us, you wouldn't have known. And I said, don't forget, people who lived here before you knew how wonderful this neighborhood was. Right. Don't forget that your good fortune, don't forget that your good fortune is at the misfortune of someone else. Yeah. So I don't mind you being here as a new New Orleanian. If you're here for 5 minutes or 50 years like me, you love the city. Mm-hmm. I give you that benefit of the doubt, but I'm not gonna sit here and be bamboozled by the idea that there are those who don't have our best interest at heart, something I learned from my parents. Mm-hmm. The other awakening that I had in this play was understanding that legacy of what my family and what my community had gone through, and how they use culture in their battle of injustice and social justice. And my parents and my grandparents taught me two mantras that I live by. There are those that do not have your best interest at heart. And then the other was, can't die 3 days before the creation of the world. Don't ever tell me you can't do something. Can't die 3 days before the creation of the world. And finally, for this section,
They already gave me the 5 minute warning.
Right. For this section, on September 8th, 2005, on the front page of the Wall Street Journal, and I will say their names, Jimmy Reese and Ashton O'Dwyer, businessmen of New Orleans, said, this is the best thing that ever happened to us. A week after, because we'll be able to get rid of the people that we don't want, change this city geographically, demographically, and politically. And if it doesn't happen, we're gonna leave. It was in print on the front page of the Wall Street Journal a week after the floods, while people were still on their rooftops. So what you have to realize was that was an awakening, that there are those who do not have your best interest at heart, and when evil people plot, good people have to plan. So here I am, waiting to respond to this. 20 years from now, some little kid was gonna come up to me and say, Mr. Pierce, in New Orleans' darkest hour, what did you do? And I decided to do a play, Waiting for Godot, this existential play that you were talking about, where people feel this void. And we did the play in the Lower Ninth Ward, and it was one of the most cathartic moments of my life. It was catharsis in its most real sense, where citizens, white, black, rich, poor, who had lost everything in this flood, came to this cathartic moment of this play in the middle of the Lower Ninth Ward, where hundreds had died on hallowed ground. I stood there and I said, in this place, at this moment in time, all mankind is us. Let us do something while we have the chance. And that's why we gather in moments like this, where we collectively, in the forum of art, reflect on what's important to us, where we've lost our way, where we've gained our way, where we know what is important, we declare what our values are, and we act on them. That's the role of art. That's what that moment did for me, and it was an awakening to how culture and art and social aid and pleasure clubs in New Orleans had saved a generation, that the creation of jazz in Congo Square had given Africans captured the ability to rise up in insurrection and find their freedom, to give way to a vision to actually create American aesthetic of freedom within form, that we can be a land of laws, but at the same time, find our individuality and create these wonderful jazz improvisations. High art is in politics, in infrastructure, in science. It is when the technical proficiency meets expressive thought, and you can create something and are moved to do something. What thoughts are to the individual as you lie awake at night, that's what art is for the society as a whole, that place where you reflect on who you are, declare what your values are, and act on them. And then it was that moment that I realized that for me, this was a homecoming. And if you just indulge me, and then we'll go to Q&A. This is the story of my homecoming. This is the story of my part in the pilgrimage of my family and my people out of exile. It is a story of faith and hope and love.
That's the
And it is a story that begins with a slave child waving goodbye to his family on the banks of the river as the boat carried himself into an abyss of suffering. That I am here to tell the tale at all means it is not tragedy. It means that as long as we draw breath, tragedy, even tragedy as overwhelming as a hurricane that nearly destroyed a city, does not have to have the last word. Like the poet W.H. Auden says, we stagger onward, rejoicing. Those car lights I saw the night on Claiborne Avenue Bridge belonged to New Orleanians who were also a part of this pilgrimage. I did not know it then, and they didn't either, but I am certain of it now. Those fellow pilgrims were headed into the Lower Ninth Ward to affirm by their presence that the power of art, the bonds of the beloved community, and the perseverance of the human spirit are all lights that the darkness cannot overcome. In American culture, we have turned away from an awareness of the prophetic power of art, of its role as a means of revealing the hidden order beneath everydayness, and its power to transform us and the world. Art tells us who we are, and it tells us who we must become. Art doesn't give us life's answers as much as it empowers us to live life's questions. Art, like religion, is how the eternal and the ideal enters time and becomes real. In turn, it is how we mortals experience, if only for a moment, immortality. Art is how we humans, individually and collectively, impress our seal on the wax. It's how we charge ordinary matter, wood, paint, stone, a word, a voice, a note, a gesture, with life and spirit and harmony. Art is the most serious thing we can do, because when making it, we humans forged in the image of God are most like our Creator. And we tend to forget that. In this production of Godot, in that weary time and in that storm-battered place, helped me remember, and I was far from the only one. Early in the play's first act, Vladimir hears a noise and thinks it might signal Godot's approach. Pah, snorts Estragon dismissively. The wind in the reeds. We would be wrong to dismiss that sound. Man is only a reed, said the French philosopher Blaise Pascal, but he is a thinking reed. When the winds of adversity blow hard against him, the sound they make as they pass over his contours may be mere noise, or they may be something like the music of teenage Sidney Bechet, grandson of a slave made when he blew across his clarinet's reed. And standing on the back of a New Orleans furniture truck next to a horn-playing juvenile delinquent named Louis Armstrong created jazz. I learned from the late Albert Murray, the great Harlem connoisseur of black music, that art is the way individuals and cultures react aesthetically to their experiences in life. Jazz and the blues, the most American of all musical forms, is the sound made by history's savage gales blowing hard on African people in the diaspora. The storm-tossed reeds may be humble. The reeds are thinking. The reeds are feeling. And the reeds are resilient. The reeds sing a song of triumph. The harder the wind blows, the stronger our spirit, the purer our art, and the greater our victory. The wind in the reeds. So,
ladies and gentlemen, Wendell Pierce.
Thank you.
At this moment, we will start the Q&A. There is a mic up in the balcony as well. We have about 7 minutes, so if there's anyone down here, and I knew it was going to start all the way in the back.
And I'll remember the three B's, the five B's. Be brief, brother, be brief.
No, I will try.
Not you, not no, you, me.
Okay, me. All right, well, that's good. There's so much I just want to say, but first I want to say thank you so much for giving us so much insight into what's going on in New Orleans. So I had an opportunity to participate in Christmas for Katrina through Florida A&M University, and I was there and saw the X's and the numbers on the houses showing us how many dead bodies were in those houses, and got to meet so many kids who had gone through this experience, and it was very traumatic for just everyone involved. But you talked about your neighborhood and all of the benefit that has gone into New Orleans since Katrina. I'm curious to know, do you feel like your neighborhood has been brought back to what it was once before, or has it just been completely reborn because of the change happening in New Orleans, something that not even benefit could bring the neighborhood back to where it was?
It's a mixed bag. We know what it was before and what it can be, and so we're trying to get back to that. At the same time, there's something new. We welcome all the new families that for them it's their first opportunity to own a home and move up like it was for my parents in the 1950s. The core values of what we're trying to do, which is have people own a home and have a wonderful neighborhood to live in. Everyone shares that value, and we're at different degrees and different stages of it. We're still fighting the same battles as a resident-initiated redevelopment. You know, they put prohibitions on us. We can't sell to anyone in this room, probably, because we can only sell to the 80% average median income and below, because it was a part of the Hope Six project. That's when good people, when bad people plot, evil people, plot, good people have to plan. And so we know that they purposefully are trying to push the poor out of the inner part of the city near the French Quarter and all this valued land, and then they restrict us to only sell to the poor. I have no problem with that. That's how my parents built their wealth. But I've had to turn away people in my generation who said, hey, Wendell, here's $150,000. I want to buy a house across from my grandmother because I'm going to be a part of the rebirth. And I can't sell to them. Now, why would you put that restriction on unless you have some nefarious idea of when we tear down all these projects, Robert Taylor Home, Cabrini Green, all right? We're going to force you to take these folks as we take this wonderful property next to the Loop, the French Quarter. Right? So you have to realize, so it's coming back. We also have to realize it's a tale of two cities. You know, 100,000 people, predominantly poor, predominantly African-American, haven't been able to come back. When I started this tour, they were just framing up one of our larger public housing developments. They tore down the big four, as they call them. Two-thirds of it market value, only one-third public housing, not one for one to bring it back. So just by that, we're going to get rid of a whole bunch of folks. It's been 10 years, and you're just framing it up? Those poor people that you pushed out probably have a life someplace else and have placed their roots someplace else. So I like to call that displacement by delay, right? But the poetic truth is the matter that kids from Florida A&M and from University of Chicago and from Southern University and from all over the world, I remember a neighbor came to me on so many religious organizations came and saved New Orleans. That's the poetic truth of all of the bad that this seemingly cynical guy up here keeps talking about. The poetic truth is good people of goodwill of all walks of life came to help us. And I had a neighbor come to me and said, Wendell, I'm really nervous. And you know all about this stuff. I'm like, yeah, they got these people coming to help rebuild my house. I'm like, yeah, I ain't never heard of these people. I was like, who, Mr. Wilson? Who are the Mennonites? I ain't never heard of no Mennonites. I ain't never heard of no Mennonites.
That house will last another 150 years.
And I said, no, they're good people. They're good people. So that's the poetic truth. So, yeah.
We'll take our next question, and this will be our last question.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Back
I was going to be brief.
I do want to remind you all that the book Purchasing is going to be right out here. And the book signing is going to be on the second floor.
It's a pleasure to see you, Mr. Pierce. I'm from New Orleans. I grew up in Treme. I'm tempted to use my New Orleans dialect when speaking to you.
What? Baby, baby, how you doing?
Whatever, baby.
That's right. Go ahead, Chef.
So we lived in Treme across from Congo Square on North Villery, right across the street.
Absolutely.
I used to watch The Wire with my father and my mother. That was family time. And my father used to say that one of the things he loved the most about The Wire was how much it reminded him of home, of New Orleans and of Treme. So my question is, when you were filming The Wire during those 5 years, did you ever think of it that way? Did you ever think of those universal themes that also resonated with what you saw and experienced at home?
First of all, the more specific you are with your art, and when I say art, I mean art in the sense of science, art within math, art within politics, that merger of technical proficiency and expression, the more specific you are with your work, the more universal it becomes. When I was doing The Wire, there'll be a little blue-haired lady from Park Avenue come and go, oh, I watch The Wire, it speaks to me, right? And you would, catch some cat, no matter where I went, there was always some guy looking around like this and say, listen, man, listen, don't look directly at me, because I'm hustling, I'm hustling, but y'all really got the game down. It speaks to me, right? And the same guy looking around in New Orleans on the parade route in plain clothes, looking around, right, don't look directly at me, but I'm on the job, I'm undercover. And y'all finally got the police work together on The Wire. It speaks to me. Actually, on The Wire, there's the, I didn't know about this until my girlfriend pointed out to me, the website, What White People Like, right? And I had never seen it. And The Wire was up there, So the proudest thing I am about The Wire is the fact that really good material, the more specific it is, the more it resonates with people. And you will never pass a kid on the corner in a white tee, disenfranchised, and not look at him and see his humanity, which is what we try to remind people of on the Wire. Baltimore reminds me of New Orleans. Church on every corner, barroom on every other, same wonderful things of culture, great crabs. We had a big crab off in New Orleans all the time with Treme. The people from Baltimore said, no, we steam them. And we say, no, you boil them. You don't put the seasoning on the shell like y'all do. We had a big fight, and we have a big, great crab boil. So the cities reminded me of each other. But everywhere I went, people always said, I know it was set in Baltimore, but it reminds me of Chicago. I know it was set in Baltimore, but this is really about St. Louis, right? Mm-hmm. I know it's set in Baltimore, but it's really about L.A. And what that was saying was the dysfunction that we find in our American cities as described and displayed on The Wire was right there in our own cities. And that's what we see. And I tell people, even in the book, I may be talking about culturally what has happened to my community, but it's a very specific thing. And it's a very uniquely American experience of how we as African Americans in our culture, in our communities, took our culture made it a part of our everyday life, but that should speak to everyone. It reminds me of when I was in Grant Park, 2008. I was hanging out with about five white women from Chicago who had worked on the president's campaign like I had, and they stepped back from me when he won. And just, your moment, right? And I'm in tears, and I'm like, no, don't step back. This is our moment. This is the American moment. One of the most fascinating and most beautiful things about that night really was John McCain's speech. The absolute just humility and saying what a defining moment this is for our country and the evolution from America's original sin. We should all celebrate what happened today. That was the most amazing speech for me. And so that's why I say, yes, it reminded me of New Orleans, The Wire, but The Wire's authenticity spoke to everyone. And so we should never look at our dysfunction and think we are not a part of it. People in Evanston should be disturbed by what's happening with young men in the south side of Chicago. Because that's your community, that's your neighbors. Mm-hmm. That's your neighbors, right? And so, that's what good art is supposed to do. It reminds us, what makes something classic, like Waiting for Godot, is the fact that it can speak to our humanity across time and place and race and the disparate variables that make us different. Why we can have a play written under Nazi occupation in Paris speak to the people of Sarajevo in the 80s when Susan Sontag, I was corrected, did it in during the Balkan Wars, and that play on that hallowed ground in the Lower Ninth Ward could speak to everyone there, saying, we don't have to look for Godot, this thing outside of ourselves. Let's look for it within ourselves. At this place, in this moment of time, all mankind is us. Let us do something while we have the chance. Art can do that, even when you disagree with the artist. It's mourning in America. It moved people, right? It moved people. Ronald Reagan, it's mourning in America. All right, oh, okay, right? Willie Guthrie, this land is your land, this land is my land, from California to the New York Island, right? And you being a New Orleanian, I know how you felt, how mournful you felt the first time after Katrina when you heard Pop sing, do you know what it means to miss New Orleans and miss her each night and day? Because you thought you may not see her again. So artists have always moved us in times of great peril, of great triumph, of great beauty. It's the forum where we collectively decide on what we're going to do, declare what our values are, and act on them. Now, Winston Churchill said, it takes courage to stand up and say something, but it even takes more courage to shut up and sit down and listen. And so now I will listen. Thank you all for coming.